It's very important at this point in time when we are facing water stress and water scarcity in many parts of the country. Also, the government of India, as part of the Jal Shakti Abhiyan, has taken up Catch the Rain program, which also revolves around rainwater harvesting. So first and foremost, you know, I just wanted to reflect on water and how water is different from other resources. So while we have energy in our house, like electricity supply, and we don't mind paying any amount for electricity, but when it comes to water, along with being an economic good, it is, of course, a social good first. And without water, life probably would not be there. So, and that water is becoming scarce, is evident that water now shares a space on the Wall Street alongside gold and oil. So when we look at water, we have to look at it a little differently. And I'm sure all of you present here will agree with me that we cannot look at, you know, incentivizing it monetarily. Like, for instance, you know, you say, generally people ask this question, what is in it for me? So if I'm looking for rainwater harvesting, why should I be doing rainwater harvesting? What is in it for me? I am getting water in my house. In Delhi, everybody gets water from Delhi Jal Board. We get water for an hour or 2 hours in the morning, but we have the luxury of using a pump and pumping it into our tanks. And then we have water 24/7 available in our houses. So there is no incentive to save water. 20,000 liters of water is free in Delhi. And beyond that, in case you are using, it's highly, I would say, subsidized. And hence, you know, we pay sort of about 200 to maybe 1,000 rupees if somebody would be using too much of water. But of course, when the government says that you install rainwater harvesting, somewhere we don't see personal benefit in terms of monetary benefit. But please understand, so that's why this picture, you know, depicts the story of the crow, you know, the thirsty crow. So if we don't save water, then our situation is going to become like a thirsty crow, wherein, you know, we would have money, but we would be just looking around for water, but would not have water anywhere. And probably that's evident already in India when we had day zero in Chennai, we had day zero in Shimla. And of course, in Delhi also, there are periods in summer season wherein we don't have, like we really have water stress within the city itself. So it cannot be. So when you're looking at water, you have to look at water differently. And hence I always say that economic instruments don't work when it comes to water. We have to look at probably, you know, psychological instruments, or we have to look at hitting the emotional cord and telling people to understand that if you don't save water today, you will not have water tomorrow. So coming to the situation, you know, Niti Aayog came out with a report in 2018, the Composite Water Index report, which was there. And that report very clearly shows that by 2030, the overall demand is expected to exceed supply twofold by 2030. And 40% of the population will have no access to drinking water. Of course, this was something that was forecasted for 2020, which said that 21 cities, including Delhi, would run out of groundwater by 2020. And 6% of the GDP will be lost by 2050 due to water crisis if the business as usual continues. Let's accept that almost about 85% of the jobs are directly or indirectly linked with water. So moving ahead, as I've told you that the population, of course, of the country is increasing, and per capita water availability, which was almost over 5,000 meter cube per year, per person, it has now dropped roughly to about 1400, and it is going to further reduce. But when I say 1400, not everybody has the luxury of having that 1400. It's only an average figure that we are talking about. This picture, I've clicked it in Vasant Kunj. So I live in Vasant Kunj, and this is something that while going to my office, I witness every day that this water tanker comes. And if it's not around, people are waiting there. But when it comes, this is how it looks like, where, you know, you see some people climbing on top, and at the end of it, you know, there are few who are left with no water still. So sources of raw water in Delhi. So we have surface water as well as groundwater that is there. And we get water from Yamuna River, Ganga River, Bhakra storage, and of course, groundwater as well. And if you look at the gap right now, even when Delhi is supplying water to tap water to houses, still there is a demand supply gap that is there. So while the total requirement is 1260 million gallons per day, water production is only about 937 million gallons per day. But that 937 that we are talking about, that's only water production. Also, there is water loss in when the water gets transmitted. So when you are transferring water, there is what we call non-revenue water or unaccounted for water. That is close to about 40%. So a lot of water gets lost. And that's why many households you will see in Delhi have their private borewell. Even RWAs have their private borewell to supplement what we are getting from the Delhi Jal Board. And likewise, when we look at wastewater also, not all wastewater gets treated. It's roughly about 60% of it is getting treated and the rest goes as raw sewage into our nearest water body. It could be the drains which are there, or from the drains it goes to the Yamuna River. And I'm sure all of you are aware of the quality of water which is there in Yamuna River. So water issue, when we talk about, it's not just the quantity issue, but it's also the quality issue. So the water quality of the source is not good, then probably the one that you're getting even after treatment on your taps may not be of the right quality. So this is something that, let me just take this up. I don't know. Let me just try moving it up. So we were talking about the gap, which I have already told you about it. So it's only 81% of the Delhi households have piped water supply. There are some villages that you see here are the worst affected. This has been taken from Times of India newspaper, and this is dated 21st June 2019, the data that we are sharing right here. Delhi is, of course, looking at different models, you know, looking at Singapore model and multiple like decentralized STPs and a lot of other models are being looked at. But without community participation, any of these initiatives which we are talking about may not be successful. Right. And the groundwater table, this data is quite dated, I would say. This is like 2013 data. But when I'm looking at the 2013 data also, I see that, so you see here that in Chhatarpur, in South Delhi especially, the situation is quite bad. So the water, groundwater depletion that we are talking about is much more in South Delhi, where at least I am seated here. It's quite bad, but other parts of Delhi also, it's not too great. And the water has been depleting anything between like 30% in the last decade, it has depleted, like groundwater level has gone down, anything between 30% to 200%. And alongside that, there's also the issue of toxins. So when we are talking about rainwater harvesting, please understand that rainwater is the purest form of water that you are getting. Yes, you need to go for the first flush, but after the first flush, the water that you store is pure. But look at the number of toxins that you have in Delhi. You can see nitrate, arsenic, fluoride. So there are different pockets, even cadmium, chromium, lead. So all these toxic elements are present in water in different parts of different districts of Delhi. So with that, I will move pass on to Jayati.
Yeah. So before we move on to understanding what are the various techniques which one can use for rainwater harvesting, just a quick capture of the very, very important points which you pointed out, Fauzia. One is that, of course, the water table is depleting. We are on our way to having a much lesser supply than the demand is already. But the very, very important point, which maybe a lot of us don't know, is the problem with tanker water. One is the wastage, and one is that the other kind of sources of water are all contaminated as compared to such a good source of water which we're just wasting, which is rainwater. So the sheer quality difference itself for our health is a compelling reason to look at rainwater as a source as compared to any other source which we're getting right now. So that is a very, very valuable point. Thank you. Especially with health being such an important issue right now, I think that would be a great reason for people to go for it. So yes, if you can just help us understand what are the various techniques of rainwater harvesting that can be used.
So Jayati, since you actually pointed out health, I just want to say that people try to save money on installing rainwater harvesting. And they say that, oh, we have to install, we have to maintain. But they don't understand the amount of money, the medical expenses that they incur because of waterborne diseases. So if you start accounting for that, probably, you will be motivated to have a rainwater harvesting. In fact, I just see Amod, he's put it in the chat box that they are planning for a rainwater harvesting. That's so wonderful. I think it's just the need of the day that you need to really shift towards that. So now let me move on and so we have understood why, and we have understood that there is a problem. A problem exists. We have water today. The water still is not of the right quality. I'm sure all of you have RO in your houses. If it was of the right quality, or if you had trust in your utility, you would not be installing RO. We also know that when we keep an RO in our houses, we actually waste 3 times the water that we filter. But somehow, we still lack that motivation to install rainwater harvesting. And today, the whole purpose of being, having this discussion and having you here attend this is perhaps, that if we could sort of give you at least few reasons and few ways, and of course, connect you with people as to how you can go about installing rainwater harvesting. So let me look at the government perspective. So the government, you can see here, we have this data here, which tells us that depth of water level below groundwater. And this region, of course, we have greater than 40 meters. Here we have 20 to 40 meter. And the government has been contemplating on augmenting the supply. So a lot of effort on the supply side management is being undertaken by the government. Of course, the rainwater harvesting being one of them, and the public buildings have now rainwater harvesting installed, most of the public buildings, at least the new ones that are coming up, it has become mandatory to install rainwater harvesting. So for rainwater harvesting, what do we need? We need a catchment. What is a catchment? It's a structure of land area that is used to collect rainwater. I'm sure everybody present here knows that. It could be your roof, whether it's flat or whether it's sloping roof. You can have a gutter here, whether it's your park, whether it's the road, playground, anything could be the catchment. Any open space, roof, courtyard, anything could be the catchment for rainwater harvesting. Then the techniques which are there, so you can have a recharge pit. So many places we have the recharge pit. For instance, the place where I stay, the Defense Officers Enclave in Vasant Kunj, where I live, we have these storm water drains through which the water goes into a recharge pit, and all the rainwater. So from the roof, it comes to the storm water drain, and through the storm water drain, it goes to the recharge pit, and then gradually there is a filtering system within the recharge pit. And where you have boulder, gravel, coarse sand, and then it goes and recharges the groundwater. So this could be depending on the size of the roof. So this, like this roof, it says about 100 square meters. So it could be like 1 to 2 meters wide and up to 3 meters deep, you could have this. And then you could also use the abandoned hand pump or running hand pump. So many areas or many RWAs in Delhi who traditionally had private bore wells have now shifted to the water being supplied by the DJP. So you may be still having those bore wells which are abandoned. So we have to do a functionality test of these bore wells. And after you have carried out a functionality test of the bore well, you can use it for recharging water either in the shallow aquifer or in the deep aquifer, depending on to what depth you're from where you are drawing water. So shallow aquifer, of course, is your unconfined aquifers, but now people have actually started mining water and gone deeper and into deep aquifers as well. So, but a functionality test of the abandoned borewell is important prior to using it for recharging the groundwater. So you can take the rainwater, you can connect it, you can put a filtering media. So that's very important to filter it. You can't just put it directly and pollute the groundwater. Where you have to ensure that the water that you're recharging in the groundwater is also pure. So a simple filtering media is required prior to putting it into the groundwater. You can also look at having a recharge trench that is there. So recharge trench is a more shallow thing. You can have it around the periphery of your RWA, and all the water that is, so recharge trench would be roughly about 2 meters deep, and it could be about 1.5 meters wide. And then again, it again has boulders, pebbles, gravel in it. And the water that goes here gradually then seeps into the groundwater. So that's another way of looking at connecting your rainwater from your roof, collecting it and diverting it to the recharge trenches which are there. Dug wells, again, sometimes, you know, you will have areas where there are abandoned dug wells which are there. If you don't have an abandoned dug well, you could even consider having a dug well, and through that also you can use it for recharging of groundwater. So these are sort of recharging of groundwater, but you can also consider storing water on the surface and using it. So I will be showing you a video about how you can store it and use it as well. So there's another concept which is there is rain garden, which aesthetically also looks very nice. And you can have, you can divert the water from your locality into the rain garden, and you can actually grow nice flowers there. So it looks good, but again, it has layers of gravel and pebble and sand within it so that the water gradually seeps into the groundwater as well. So what is the potential for rainwater harvesting? It's a very simple formula that you have. That is the area of your roof in square meter and your rainfall in millimeters. So you have a runoff coefficient. So what's a runoff coefficient? So there is some water that of course gets lost because of your first flush, or some water which is otherwise, you know, which because of the surface, you lose a certain amount of water. It could be even because of evaporation. We do consider that separately, but runoff coefficient is primarily because of the surface. So when we have concrete surface, the runoff coefficient is generally high. So it's like roughly about 0.8. So we don't really convert this. If you want, you can convert it to meter and then later on convert it to liters as well. So you will get your answer in meter cube and then you convert it into liters. But you could directly use it also. So for instance, if your rooftop area is 200 meters square and your rainfall is 600 millimeters, so Delhi gets an average of 611, but not all, you can't harvest all rain. So there is the certain peak period during which you can actually harvest. And 0.8 is the runoff coefficient because it's from your roof that you're taking. So this is roughly the potential of harvesting the rainfall. And if it's a family of five, and I'm not looking at just potable water, potable use, if I'm looking at all uses, which we average it at 135 liters per day, then the total requirement for a family of five is like 675 liters per day. So number of days that your water can last is roughly about 140 days. But again, if you're only using it for potable use, then probably you can safely harvest water that you can use it for the entire year. I have just put this infographic for you to actually understand that, you know, what the residents, why are residents opposing this? So residents are sort of opposing this because they feel that, you know, there is co-ownership of flats, and then who would maintain it? Who would pay for it? They also have this concern that if they dig a recharge pit, then that's going to be risky for the foundation of the house that is there. So several reasons that you have, and the Delhi government has also sort of taken cognizance, but at the same time, they have come up with this norm that all rooftops that are more than 100 square meters should for sure have a rainwater harvesting structure. They're also talking about penalty worth 50% of total water bill. Again, you know, that penalty is absolutely no motivation to install. As I said, if people are using less than 20,000 liters, they're not even paying a bill. So forget about the penalty part of it. So it's more our conscience that we should feel the need for a rainwater harvesting structure and install it. Right. This is the Nizamuddin thing. I'm sure most of you would be aware of. So Nizamuddin East Society has set up this community rainwater harvesting. So their water supply there was from private boreholes, but at the same time, they also had the municipal supply there. So in 2004, the Resident Welfare Association, they came together. And as I was telling you about my locality, they also went on to have these stormwater drains, which are these stormwater drains that you can see, the blue lines which are there, they're all stormwater drains which are there. So they had a total rooftop area of Nizamuddin East, which was coming roughly about 2,916 square meter. And through these stormwater drains, the water goes to the recharge pit and it recharges the groundwater. So the total volume of water that is that they are able to harvest annually, it's roughly about 4,85,13,149 liters, and it's still operational. And the lady who was instrument, the architect Vandana Menon, so again a very good friend, and she has been advising now in Gurujal. So I'm also an advisor in Gurujal, and we often get to meet. So a lot of work we are doing already in Gurgaon district. So here, roughly about 39.6% of the total rooftop and surface runoff is being harvested. I have put the link here in case any of you want to go and visit and see it. And you can actually visit the website to get more details about it. So as I said, the catchment which is there, so rainwater from all the catchment areas of the colony, including roof, paved and unpaved areas, is conveyed and collected through stormwater drains and into a collection chamber, which is covered with perforated slab. And then this collection chamber is diverted to a recharge well, which is 1 meter by 1 meter by 2 meter, which is provided with a recharge bore with a depth of 10 meters. So that's the whole thing. And then again, as I said, very important to have a filtration system. So even when you are recharging using the rainwater, you have to ensure that you go for filtration system. Of course, now there has been a lot of effort to use wastewater to recharge ponds in Delhi. There's recent, we had a news from Dwarka as well. This video we have already seen. So I would like to complete it, Jayati, before I just stop sharing my screen. So just a couple of more slides on the vendors. So you have a large number, almost 23 vendors who are empaneled with the Delhi Jal Board. And this is the list, the updated list, which is available on the Delhi Jal Board website. It is valid up to 31st December 2021. And I think it is last year, December, that they have uploaded it. It would be good to really look at that and look at which one. So I've just put a screenshot of three, but when you click on this link, you will be able to, I'll put the link in the chat box as well. So when you click on the link, you will get the complete list. You can look for a nearest person, but you can also look for anyone who you think is more suitable. I'm sure there are many in Delhi and NCR region who are able to do this. For Gurgaon also, so Gurujal Society is doing a lot of work also related to Catch the Rain campaign, but rainwater harvesting. They're also conducting a functionality test of the installed rainwater harvesting, both in residential area as well as commercial area. If you go to their website, the Gurujal website, you will see there is a button on RWH vendors. And when you click on that, you will get a list of vendors. These list is like, this is like an updated list. It has just been put up about 2-3 weeks ago. They have updated this list. So probably you could just get access to anybody from this list. By the way, if you call up Gurujal people, they also send. So recently there was a lady who reached out to me from Gurgaon, and I connected her to the Gurujal people, and their team went and did a recce survey there, and they have also given her some recommendation for her RWA, and they would also be providing some kind of technical assistance in terms of installation of the rainwater harvesting structure. Force NGO is again working for a very long time in Delhi and NCR region, a very established organization that is there. They have an office in Vasant Kunj, but if you can Google Force NGO for rainwater harvesting, they have also, the Delhi Jal Board has also collaborated with the Force NGO, and they have set up three rain centers, rainwater harvesting centers in Delhi. And you could access those rainwater harvesting centers and get support. The government, somebody had put a question on subsidy. So yes, there is some amount of subsidy which the Delhi government was promising. I'm not sure whether it's still there, but I thought it was 50% of the total cost of installation that they were probably going to help. But you may have to go through the empaneled consultants for that. It would be good to visit the rainwater harvesting centers which are there and find out more about the subsidies. Way forward, of course, you know, this is something that I wanted to especially focus on the RWAs. That one is, of course, you need to have awareness programs like the one which we are doing right now. Also, if there is no possibility, like if you think that possibility of having individual rainwater harvesting system is difficult, which often is when it comes to a community living, then just like we saw it in the Nizamuddin East, we can look at the possibility of establishing a neighborhood level systems. Again, neighborhood level systems need not always be used for recharging of groundwater. As you saw in the video, it could also be stored in the underground sump, and it can be used for all purposes, all portable use, including drinking. So as I said, it could, and the responsibility when you have sort of a neighborhood level system, then the responsibility to keep your own roof clean is, of course, individual responsibility. You have to ensure that your rooftops are clean, your pipes and gutters are not leaking. So those things you will have to maintain. But at the community level, the tank, the sump that is there, as well as the neighbor, or if you have a recharge pit, so maintenance of the filter, the recharge pit, or the sump that is there through which you are harvesting, that will be the responsibility of the RWA, or they can hire somebody to do that as well. Open spaces, public spaces, they should also be used. Sometimes the water accumulates on the roadsides. It's very good idea, you know, that if your roadsides are lowered a bit, and if you could harvest that water underpasses, again, you know, you can divert it to the nearest low-lying area, and you can actually harvest rainwater. So we all go through a harrowing experience during monsoon season when we have very heavy showers, just a couple of heavy showers, all our underpasses and flyovers are filled with water. So the last thing here is also data on the number of RWH systems and their functional status. So in Gurgaon, I know Gurujal is doing functionality tests, but it's important that we actually have a data on what is there with us already and what more effort needs to be taken up. So that in your community, probably you can take out. I know some teachers have joined from schools. I see teachers from Loreto School, for instance, who has joined. So, and ma'am is looking at the entire, I think she's the national level coordinator. So it would be important, for instance, you know, to look at the school rainwater harvesting systems also.